This is Andy Green. I'm about to talk to Keanu Reeves and Alex Winter about Bill and Ted Face the Music, Bill and Ted Free. Thanks for doing this, guys. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
I saw the movie, watched it last night. It was fantastic. Oh, I've been waiting 29 years for this, so it was worth the wait. I saw Bogus Journey back in 91. I've been waiting ever since. So I've been hearing about this for so many years now. So just what took so long?
You know, the pyramids weren't built in a day. You know, the writers came to us about 9 years ago with an idea. And, you know, everyone involved with Bill and Ted, like Alex, myself, Chris Matheson, Ed Solomon, and the producer, Scott Kruf, who have been with the project from the beginning, have a real affection for the films. And when the writers came to us, you know, we were like, yeah, we would love to see something. And we started to work on scripts and drafts, and then people would go away and come back. And it just was taking, you know, a lot of time. Dean Parisill, the director, came on board, I guess like 5 years ago. And then as with Bill and Ted films, there's always some kind of business side of the show business side that, you know, Alex can speak to this, but you know, even the first film had
stuff.
It was like shelves for a year anyway. And then I think the overriding thing with that was just trying to tell a good story. Great story.
Yeah, that took time too. I mean, every piece of it, we were talking about this a lot as we went, because a lot of the same people were working on it, which was really great. But, you know, as Keanu said, it was Chris and Ed hatched this idea, brought it to Keanu and myself years ago. We loved it. We thought it was very funny. We've talked over the years and just never really talked about doing a third one seriously, but this premise seemed very well suited to almost any age.
Right.
In fact, it almost gets better the older you are, which worked out in our favor because it turned out we were going to be significantly older when we actually made it. Mm-hmm. By the time it got made. But they really, you know, they just, it was a love of the project for them, just like it was when they made the first one. That grew out of a stand-up routine they used to have. And this was just, you know, the pact we made, the four of us back at the beginning, was, you know, all of us are doing other things. None of us need to do this. There's no point in doing it unless we think it's going to be really good. And then they went off and they just wrote a spec script. And then we brought Scott Kruf back, our original producer. Then we got Dean. And we just really went out into the world with the same edict that if it can't be done right, there's just no point in making it at all. And ultimately, we were very lucky to be able to make it, and to make it to, you know, to those terms that we all had.
Yeah, you know, I feel like comedy sequels are the hardest kind of sequel to pull off, right? I think Bogus Journey is one of the few part twos of a comedy series that's ever worked, because it's always a temptation to just redo the first one, do the same jokes again in the same way, and they're less funny. So what pitfalls of comedy sequels were you trying to dodge?
I think one of them that pops into mind right away is a kind of nostalgia.
Mm.
And also trying to, as to your, to what you were saying, like, you know, do the same kind of things. But, and so we want, but at the same time, we wanted to keep what these characters are and what makes a Bill and Ted film. So keep that real, but also be in the present of it. And not, I mean, Alex, you've spoken to this in the sense of not wanting to be playing these guys in the present like they were in the past.
Yeah, we didn't want to make a meta movie. And also, to be fair, the writers were really adamant as well that they do something new. And we love that. That was exciting for Keanu and myself. Like, why just, you know, try to either make a reboot or a retread, but find some other way into it. And I remember the conversation we had around Bogus. It was at that Chinese restaurant. This is like, this, it was the same thing as when they hatched three. They took me and Keanu out to dinner and they gave us this riff. And I remember when they pitched us Bogus Journey, which was called Bill and Ted Go to Hell at the time. And we were like, that's awesome. Cause that's like, it's so completely unexpected. I mean, I hadn't watched it in years. I watched it again when we were doing this. And I thought, there's really no time travel in that movie at all. Like, it's really not, it's just a complete and utter, it's like Neil Young says about driving your car into a ditch after a hit, right? Like, and I think it did, there were people who were a little scratching their heads going, why wasn't that, where was the booth? But people enjoyed it. And I think we wanted to bring some of that risk back into this of like, let's do that again. Let's really kind of spin the dial and find a way into this that's not expected and bring some surprise.
Yeah, I keep thinking about pitching Bogus Journey to a studio when they must have told them, okay, they die in the first 20 minutes. Then it's a parody of The Seventh Seal. And there's no time traveling. It's just right. So fantastic.
And Rufus is played by Pam Grier, but otherwise it's the same.
Yeah. It's so brilliant and so bold, you know, because there's such a temptation to just time travel again and be more historical figures and do the same thing. But that wouldn't be as good. It would just be watered down the first movie.
Yeah.
So I want to go back to the very beginning. So tell me your memories of reading the script on the first movie and your impressions of it, but just way back then, what you thought of the first movie the first time?
Well, I think Alex and I's first kind of our first contact with Bill and Ted,
yes,
the audition process, where we didn't really, I didn't get a script for the audition. Did you, Alex?
No, I just got pages.
Yeah, so we just got pages, and I thought they were funny. In the audition process, there was a kind of Bill and Ted audition crucible. So there were about 10 actors, I would say, right? And then we would all revolve and interact with each other playing Bill and Ted, but we would sometimes go in and play Bill, sometimes we'd go in and play Ted.
Yeah.
And I think Alex and I probably came at it the same way, that we weren't commenting on the writing or the characters, you know? And I think we played it super, we didn't play them as stoners. You know, we weren't goofy. And I think that almost that first lightning strike has been the continuity that brought us all the way through Face the Music.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. I didn't really know what I liked about the pages when I got them was that, you know, at that age, you're getting a lot of material and a lot of it is very samey. And a lot of it is in those days was, and I like John Hughes movies, but it was a lot of it was, you know, sort of John Hughes. You're playing a 16-year-old who talks like a 40-year-old with, you know, neuroses and sexual hangups and, you know, and then here were these guys that went the other way. They were played straight, but they were like 9 or 10-year-olds with this extraordinarily complex language. And that idiosyncrasy struck me as I was like, I haven't read anything like that. And I can tell you, you know, like Canon, having come up by then doing theater and things like that, it's rare to get scripts when you're that young that have any language to them at all, that has any sort of complexity or rhythm or anything. And so it was just fun. And so the auditions, even though they were endless and excruciating, it was fun to, when you finally got to just go into the Bill and Ted playground and say that dialogue. And it was the same for us on this third one. We play the script, we play the dialogue. So, you know, we bring truth to it as best as we can. And that's like the aim, but it's fun to say these words. You know, they write really good words and they write words, you know, they're backed by character and intention and sincerity, but the words themselves are really fun to say.
Yeah, so tell me how you guys bonded in the early days, because the films don't work if the two of you don't have a really tight chemistry. So how did you like come together in those early days and sort of form those bonds?
I mean, it was through the audition process. You know, we bonded, we both played bass. I remember we both showed up with motorcycle helmets one day and we're like, oh, you ride bikes, I ride bikes. I remember one of the auditions, they were ridiculous. They were like 10 hours long, needlessly. And mm-hmm. So I remember one day they broke us for lunch for an audition. And I remember, like, literally, I went back, you know, we were like, want to go for a ride. We, like, took a motorcycle ride. I think went back to Reeves' house. We both jammed on bass, meaning we both played bass, which is a hilarious idiosyncrasy of our friendship, was we would actually duo jam bass. And I'm not badly. I mean, well, badly in that we're not Mike Watt or Flea, but it didn't sound horrendous. So we bonded doing the auditions. And so we became friends through that process, really. We got to know each other more through that.
Yeah. And during the making of the first movie, did it feel special? Did you think you were making something that was different, that was going to last, that would really make an impact on the culture?
No. No.
Why?
Playground, but I mean, I, if I can, just to add a little bit to what, I mean, Alex, you know, Alex comes from a theater background, you know, and I have a little bit of theater in my background, but you know, I'm classically trained. Mm-hmm. But we could also, with those kind of mutual interests, it wasn't just playing bass or riding motorcycles. You know, we had a kind of, quickly we saw our humor, you know, our dark, twisted sense of humor, and just how we could approach the roles. I mean, I always kind of talk about it, but I mean, just, you know, we're riffing on Bill and Ted and talking about Commedia dell'arte, you know, and trying to, and I could speak to Alex about that, and he could kind of share that, and then play in that. I'm sorry, that was just a
song. That was fun. So they shelved the movie for a whole year. Did you think it was dead, that it wouldn't come out, or it would be straight to video and just die?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, you know, that's what Keanu was referring to. We not only, I remember one instance, my memory is pretty terrible, but I remember one instance when we were shooting the Socrates scene in Rome, and we're sitting there sort of, you know, holding the history book and looking at, I remember the take, right? I also remember that there was traffic noise everywhere because we were shooting in the Piazza, Piazza di Venezia. And I remember Keanu and I looking at each other and going, like literally right before they called action, going, dude, no one's gonna ever see this movie. ever gonna see this movie, dude. No. Okay. Action. you know, sure enough, the movie got scrapped and was shelved, and we were told that it was never gonna be released. And it took a full year, which is, you know, at that age an eternity. So we both just moved on. Like, it wasn't even a consideration. We had an enormous amount of fun making. We really enjoyed the people that we made it with. They were all very young. Everyone worked really, really hard. Bill and Ted movies are, well, all movies are hard, so I don't want to mischaracterize it, but they are really freaking hard. And they're very physical. They're very complicated from a tone standpoint. And it's not just us, everyone, writers, producers, directors, everyone's working their backsides off. They're never made for tons and tons of money, so they're always reaching way farther than the money we have. It's, you know, they're one of those movies where, like, the frame looks really great, but if the camera moved like a quarter of a centimeter, you would see like chewing gum and string and, like, you know, people hanging upside down trying to hold a piece of a set. And they're still like that. So it was disappointing, but we'd also both, you know, we'd been around in the business and we didn't expect it to come out. And it was a kind of a sweet surprise when we were told that it was bought out of a fire sale by Nelson, and that they had tested the film and that had tested through the roof, the beginning of a little bit of hope.
Just want to talk a bit more about Bogus Journey, because I just rewatched it. It's so fantastically weird. Do you ever worry that it was going too far off in an insane direction? I mean, there's two aliens that run into each other and like one big alien. I mean, it's just so bonkers.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Did the studio balk at the weirdness? Did you get any resistance on making it so surreal?
I mean, behind the curtain or inside baseball, while we were making the film, to Alex's earlier point, we always, you know, the ambition of the films, the stories are always larger than the financial business appetite.
Right.
And there was a point where Bogus Journey, the ending of that picture, went a particular way. Just one example would be huge rabbits chasing in a highway car chase. And where the studio, eventually I started calling it Bill and Ted's omitted adventure. Because we would get these, would just be omitted. I don't think it was a creative balking at it. I think, yeah. So I guess to answer your question, no. I wasn't really privy to the behind the scenes studio stuff, but I do know that, you know, we did want to kind of make it large, even bigger, an even bigger movie.
Right.
And then I think they were like, no. but I don't think creatively there was a kind of schism there.
Well, Sadler is a brilliant physical actor. I mean, he's a brilliant actor, full stop, but he is a brilliant physical actor. And there was a there were a lot of really joyful moments making three. But I just remember the kind of feeling I had when we sort of like, I don't want to spoil anything, but when we sort of walk out of the doors and he greets us and we greet him for the first time in years. And I was like, and we shot it kind of in order, that sequence. I just remember thinking, oh yeah, here we go. We get to do this, you know, we get to get back in the ring with Sadler. And it was as satisfying as expected. He was throwing all these ad libs out. They were all genius. And we just riffed, man. Like we just like, we get into that scene at the door. We're just, it's just like on like Grey Poupon. And, that, you know, it was, I know for me, because I've been on the other side of the camera mostly for years, that's what is so great about acting, right? Like, you know, that's how I was, you know, on the first week with Keanu, where like, I think we had to do some of our weirder stuff that week. And I just remember like suiting up to do that weird stuff and like walking on the set with him. And like, it was just on, you know, I remember coming off that day, it was the patio mansion scene and just thinking, yep, that's why I enjoy this.
Yeah, it's the genius of Chris and Ed to make a character like who's deaf, but he's also sullen and bitchy and everything. It's such a crazy place to take the character. It's the perfect comedy engine, I think.
Yeah, and Sadler's very good at that. He's very good at playing the kind of the nuances of that. It's not, I mean, it is a weirdly nuanced performance.
Mm-hmm. So, well, he's like frustrated Ed. Like a frustrated narcissist and like,
yeah.
Sort of like, ugh, the condition of the world. You just bring me down. But you also bring me up.
So, did you guys get to the point where you thought three, it just wasn't gonna happen, that there wouldn't be financing. There's so many years of pushing for it. Did you ever just think, God, this will never happen?
Yes.
Yeah, all the time. Oh yeah.
Yeah. And so what drove you, Keanu, to keep pushing for it? Because you work all the time. You're in very big movies. Just what motivated you to keep pushing Hollywood to make this movie?
I don't think I was pushing Hollywood to make this movie. I mean, at heart, I mean, I love the character. I love working with Alex. I love the writing of Chris and Ed. I love the world. I mean, really, Alex was part of kind of like... Well, there had to be a reason to do it. And I think the writers came up with a really great story. And over the years, people would talk to me about, are we going to do it again? Are we going to do it again? And then that started to become even more. Like, we really felt like an interest in it. So internally, I love the characters. And then externally, people were like, people's enthusiasm for the characters became part of the reason why to make it. And then the only reason to make it was if there was a good story to tell. And that all came together.
We really believed that, and it's been like this on every Bill and Ted movie. Every single, all three of them were like this, where it was always kind of ours to lose, meaning they're idiosyncratic movies, but we want them to be idiosyncratic movies. That's really important to us. That's not the kind of thing that's an immediate get for aspects of the industry. So it's always kind of ours to lose. And we knew we had to make a film that, while being idiosyncratic and having integrity, was entertaining enough to merit existing, right? So, and a lot of that's on the writers, frankly. And so that was the pressure that was on us from the beginning, was, you know, there's got to be a reason to do this. Keanu and I would check in with each other a lot, all along the process of like, you know, is this thing holding the line? And the writers did as well, very, very important to them. And then ultimately that grew to Dean and to Scott and to the other members of the core team. But that was very much kind of the check-in all along the way. And the movies are a battle. They're a battle to get financed. They're a battle to make, like Keanu said about Bogus. And we had similar challenges on this one. The one funny thing I will say, because we're obviously older and much more involved, Keanu's produced movies at this point, and I produce my stuff that I do. And, you know, as you said earlier, we were not privy to the behind the scenes on the first. We were not on a need to know, right? So we would get pages and like they'd have asterisks and stuff scratched out, and then they would call us again like a year later and go, it's coming out, you have to do press. And that was it, right? Uh-huh. On this one, I remember Scott Kroof, the producer, saying, well, now you're gonna see what it looks like behind the curtain. Of a Bill and Ted movie. If we were like Edward Munch in The Scream, you know, it's almost better not to know.
Right. So how much did the story change from first conception of part three to the finished script?
Well, I can say that Bill and Ted having jet engines playing in the Grand Canyon as part of their music threnody is not in the final story.
I'm sure getting to the story was tough because part two ends and Bill and Ted are a huge rock band playing the Grand Canyon, going to the moon, the cover of Rolling Stone. So where do you go from there? I'm sure it's a challenge to find a way to make it grounded again, right?
I guess so. I think that that was easier. That part of it was easier than one would expect, because in a way, that's the comic conceit, because success is so fleeting and it is so mercurial. And,
right.
You know, the idea that that things did not continue as planned is just a good comic joke because it's just true, right? Mm-hmm. It's funny because it's true. It's the adage that your life that you think is prescribed is absolutely not going to go as planned. And so there was a relatability to that at its core that I think that Keanu and I thought was hilarious from the get-go. I think that was one of the first things they said was, okay, cut to 25 years later, and it didn't work. You know, full stop, that's it. And that's, I buy that. I think it's hilarious. So that seemed like a good jumping off point. I think that, that there were tonal questions about how you play these characters, how much, you know, joy for life they still have, and how you sort of weave in time travel and aspects like that. There were challenges. There were logic challenges. The guys are always really concerned about having time travel logic, and you know, we had the benefit of a quantum theorist who's quite brilliant, who helped us with that stuff. Seriously, we did. He's great, Spiros Mikolakis from Caltech, but. You know, there were a lot of challenges, and as Keanu said earlier, there were a lot of budget challenges. There were a lot of, like, we got to do this instead of that. I mean, we would have Keanu and I worked 7 days a week, and on weekends we just sat with the script and worked through logic and worked through how to sort of meet whatever challenge was facing us that week, which was usually giant.
Do you see any big difference between Bill and Ted? Like, the characters are so similar and so locked together, almost like Siamese twins in a way. Just where do you see like big differences in their personalities?
Certainly internally, I think they're markedly different. And I think that's, there's a kind of a salt and pepper or sweet and sour vibe to them. I mean, it fluctuates. It's not very black and white, but that's where a lot of the comedy comes from. Even internally within a scene, there's usually some sort of internal diametric opposition, not in terms of our goals or our worldview, but even just emotionally or in terms of how we're responding to a challenge or a crisis that's in front of us, that I think is where a lot of the comedy comes from. I think that that our energies are actually quite different as well, which I think there's a lot of comedy in that. And I you know, not to the point of not getting too pedantic about it, you know, I had zero power and not much of a clue on Bill and Ted One. And so I spent a lot of Bill and Ted One on an Apple box to even out our height. And on this one, I was like, don't give me an Apple box. Like, you know, Ted is taller than Bill. Like, let that be a thing. Like, that's a good thing, right? And even in marketing, they kept like trying to even us out. I was like, we're not the same height. Like, Keanu's got a lot of inches on me, and that's good. That's like, differentiation is good, right? Yeah. So I think I even tried to lean into the comedy of that on this one a bit, like just playing up some of those differences are subtle, but I think in physical comedy, they sort of like we were saying about, you know, theater, that's where a lot of the comedy comes from.
Yeah. And so how did it feel on the first 2 days of filming when you're back in character for the first time in 29 years and you're working with the same people, and there's William Sadler and there's the actor who's playing your dad, Keanu? I'm sure it felt surreal to be back in that world after so many decades.
The thing that's, you know, so familiar is that, you know, Alex and I were, you know, preparing the role, working on the script, spending time together. And we had a couple of weeks before we started filming. So that kind of got me used to the waters. And then once we got going to it, there's so much fun to play, and it's so much fun to work with Alex. And,
you know, just going back to something he said at the beginning, like there's something about the way we both approach characters physically, and having, we both have a love of drama and theater, and the characters are quite theatrical. They're not theatrical in that they're artificial, but they are very physical. And it's really about engaging with the text, with your body. And that for me is really, I know that sounds probably a little effete for the purposes of this discussion, but it's really true. Like for me, when we started work on the first day, or really sort of by day one, day two, day three, it wasn't so much like, oh, you know, I've known you a long time, so this is nice or whatever. It was really like we're both engaging with the text with our bodies again. And that's really fun to play, and it's really fun to work off someone else who's doing that and coming at it the same way. And that's why Sadler fits in this world so well, because that's very much the way he acts. And not everyone does that. And it's not like it's bad if they don't. It's just not what how everyone approaches acting. And that, for me, is why I found the returns relatively effortless, was just because just getting back in the ring with Keanu in that way, we just do, it's very natural. Like, I'll do a riff, he'll do a riff. He'll do something, I'll riff. I don't even think about it, you know? It's a fun playground to be in.
Yeah, I'd love to hear a bit about Chris and Ed and just what makes them just so unique as writers, because they infuse so much heart in the story, which it could be just a goofy movie that is not grounded, but you really care about the characters. You care about their dynamic and their relationships. You talk about how Chris and Ed are so talented at balancing those two things.
Yeah, I mean, they've created these two characters that have a unique voice, and they are the shepherds. Well, we might be shepherds, they're creators, but they're shepherding too. And, you know, the wordsmithing of the wordsmithing with just the intention, the kind of heightened reality, but grounded in reality, you know, they have the métier of the characters. I think they care so much about the characters. You know, I mean, for me, I still relate to it as, you know, a privilege to be kind of handed a flame. You know, here is the flame of Ted Theodore Logan. Mm-hmm. And I will take care of it. I will honor and treasure it. But they also say, and make it your own. And yeah. You know, so, which is a wonderful collaboration. And they have their kind of polar opposite, yet the same kind of dynamic too, which I think is part of the energy of it.
Yeah, and they made you guys age appropriate, that there's always a danger that you're going to be playing teenagers that are older now, but you cared about your marriage and your children. This was Bill and Ted, they're age appropriate, but yes, to themselves, which is a very cool balance to walk also.
Yeah, and you know, the thing is, you know, that was a question we got asked a lot, even as it was being developed, was how are you going to play those guys at this age? And the fact is, you know, I know a lot of people who are very similar to the way they were in their teens and 20s. Not everyone is. Some people really radically change. And some people really don't. Their dress, you know, the way they wear their clothes, the way they move physically, the way they approach the world. And especially in music, I have a lot of friends who are musicians, and music is such a, I don't know, pure is the right word, but it's, you know, it's a very sort of essential art form. And a lot of my friends who are musicians are the same as they were when they were 19 or 20. So I know for myself, I was taking a bit from that because I wanted to play, you know, we were very intent on playing these guys authentically. So it wasn't about like trying to imitate who we were as much as looking at the world in a way as people who are very similar to the way they were, but in a way they're also very different, and we wanted to lean into that as well.
I think the timing is good in a way that people are really ready to escape to fantasy world and laugh again. There's so few great comedies out there these days that a really funny one, I just think that the world is ready to just embrace it. That's how I'm saying it.
Okay, good. We'll go with that.
I hope so. I mean, it's... Yeah. Being made a wonderful film, and everybody who's been working on it. So there's a lot of love in the meal that is prepared. So
yeah, from the second it started, I was just smiling. It was like seeing old friends again. Again, I've been waiting 29 years for this. I was 10 years old. I'm almost 40. So I think lots of people are in my same shoes, that there's a hunger to see these two guys again.
That's great. I love that.
And you get to see a lot of different versions of these guys.
That is true.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Yeah. Yeah, there's so many prosthetics and bald caps. I mean, I'm sure that was a blast. Yeah. Do you see any chance of a part four?
I don't know. Let's see how this one is received. We're not thinking about that at all.
Right.
No. There's been a lot of work, and there's been an enormous amount of work on this one. And because of COVID and everything else, like every other film, there continues to be an enormous amount of work. So I think we're all very much in this moment.
Yeah. Great. Well, I think that should do it, guys. Thanks again. I loved it. I'm so happy it finally happened.
Thanks so
much. With the wait. So thanks for doing this. This is what I needed in my life now. So I'm so happy it happened.
Oh, I'm so glad to hear that. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So thanks to you both.
Okay.
Cheers.
Bye. Bye-bye.